हेलो एवरीवन. सो टुडे वी हैव डॉक्टर जितेश अग्रवाल विथ अस फॉर दिस रिसर्च टॉक सीरीज. सो आई जस्ट इंट्रोड्यूस डॉक्टर जितेश अग्रवाल. ही हैज कंप्लीटेड हिज पीएचडी फ्रॉम आईआईटी इंदौर इन दिस डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग एंड ही हैज वर्कड इन द फील्ड ऑफ ब्रॉडबैंड डिटेक्टर्स, अल्ट्रावायलेट डिटेक्टर्स, mostly oxide semiconductor based detectors and other optoelectronic devices. He has worked on synthesis of variety of zinc oxide nanostructures and investigated various optical and electrical properties. He has also studied the plasmonic effect of metal nanoparticles over the device performances. He has published more than 15 SCI indexed articles, especially in IEEE electron device letters, sensors letters, IEEE PTL and many more. Currently, he is working as a research associate in the ISRO RESPOND project titled Development of High Sensitivity Jetano Nanostructures Based Gas Sensors, especially for space applications. So today, Dr. Jitesh will be presenting his talk on the optoelectronic devices using oxide semiconductors. Now over to Dr. Jitesh Agrawal. Welcome to IIIT. Please start your talk.
Thank you, sir, for your kind introduction. Okay. So now let's start our talk today. And the title of the talk is Oxide Semiconductors Based Optoelectronic Devices. So first of all, what is optoelectronic devices? What does it mean? So a device which will convert the optical signal into electrical signal or electrical signal into optical signal will be termed as optoelectronic devices. Like in case of LEDs or laser, these are devices which will convert the electrical signal into optical signal. And in other way, in case of photo detectors or solar cells, these are devices which are converting the input optical signal into electrical signals. So to develop this kind of optoelectronic devices, you have to firstly choose a material, that which material we will choose to develop this kind of devices. So most important thing is the band gap of the semiconducting material. Like as we know that in case of LEDs and in case of photo detector as well, the band gap is very important. Like if you excite electron from the valence band to conduction band, then when the electron will recombine with the electron, it will lose its energy in form of either heat or in terms of photon. If your device is direct band gap material, then it will emit the energy in terms of photon, and the energy of emitted photon will be equivalent to the band gap of the material. Therefore, when you want a specific color in LED, or if you want to detect a specific wavelength in the detector, then band gap is very critical. It should be equivalent to the required or desired wavelength. Second thing is especially in case of photo detectors, the absorption coefficient of the material should be quite higher, otherwise it won't be able to sense the big signals. The next important thing is larger surface area of your material, because either it is LED or it is a detector, the surface area is very important because it is the most sensitive part of the material. Therefore, if you have larger surface area, then your device can easily detect the incident photons. And how it is that much critical, that I will explain in the next slides. High charge transportation efficiency. So this parameter is also very critical. Suppose you have obtained the electron hole pairs at the depletion region in the p-n junction, but if they are not able to transport from the place where they have generated to the respective electrodes, then you won't get any output signal. So it will have no use. Therefore, material should have high charge transport efficiency there, so that the mobile charge carriers can reach to the respective electrodes. Also, the material should be of low cost, and it will be of low cost if it is easily available. And also, the processability cost is very low if it is easy to fabricate. And if you see, the band gap is very important thing here. And if we look at the conventional semiconductors like silicon or germanium, their band gap is around 1.3 or below that. So we cannot use these semiconducting material for the detection of UV region where the band gap is more than 3 electron volts. Therefore, we required some other materials which can work in that region, in UV, specifically for UV and for visible region. Therefore, we are looking towards the metal oxide semiconductors. As you can see here, for the visible and IR region, there are plenty of materials available, including silicon, cadmium sulfide, gallium arsenide, and so on. But if you want to work in the specifically in UV region, there are majority of material are in the are metal oxides like zinc oxide, tin oxide, titanium oxide for the UVA region, and for UV region, UVC region, there are gallium oxide, indium gallium oxide, zinc germanium oxide, and etc. So you have large range of materials that can be used for the UV detection and also for UV emission as well. And these are the list of different kind of applications which you can develop using the metal oxides, like diodes, sensors, solar cells, random access memories, transparent conducting electrodes, which is also very important. If you see in case of LCD displays, in LEDs, and also in case of photo detectors, you all need one transparent conducting electrode from which you can get emission. Otherwise, both electrodes are opaque, then you won't get emission from the LED. And similarly, in case of detectors as well, if you want to detect light, then it should reach to the your sensing material. And if both electrodes are not transparent, or both electrodes are opaque, then light won't reach to that sensitive material, and you won't get any output. So one of the most basic optoelectronic device is light emitting diode. It is a two terminal PN junction device. As you can see in the diagram, the holes from when you apply a forward bias, sufficient forward bias, then the holes from the P region will inject in the N-type region, and also electron which are majority charge carriers in the N-type will reach to the P-type region, and there the recombination will take place. And while the electrons are recombining from conduction band to valence band, the emitted energy will be equivalent to the forbidden gap of the material. Okay, this process is called lateral luminescence, where you are applying input electric field and getting output in terms of optical energy. So by varying the band gap using different materials, you can obtain different color LEDs. Like if you are using gallium arsenide, you will obtain red or infrared light. If you are using gallium nitride, it will give bright or blue light. Then yttrium gallium garnet will provide white light emission. Gallium phosphide will, depending on the configuration, what ratio you are using gallium and phosphate, will produce different color of emission like red, yellow, green lights. Aluminium gallium nitride will generate UV light emission, and aluminium gallium phosphate will provide green light emission. Another major optoelectronic device is solar cells. These are also PN junction device, and when the light will incident in that PN junction here, so electron hole pairs will generate, and due to the internal high built-in electric fields, then the electron and holes will drift to the respective electrodes, and you will get output current. And the next very basic optoelectronic device is photo detectors. So what is basically photo detector means? It is an optoelectronic device which will convert optical signal into electrical signal. How it is happening, as I have shown in the schematic, when the light incident on in the especially in the depletion region, the electrons will be excited from the valency band to the conduction band, and due to high internal built-in electric field, due to the presence of these immobile ions, and the built-in electric field will be much higher, and the electron will be drift toward the N side, and hole will be drift toward the P side. That will lead to the high drift current in the device. So when we are developing a photo detector in our lab, there are a few characteristics which we are looking forward. First is high sensitivity at the operating wavelength. The device, if you are developing a very wavelength selective photo detector, then it should be sensitive to that particular wavelength only, not to the all wavelength. If you are developing broadband photo detector, then it should detect the whole region for which it is developed. So high sensitivity is a very important thing. Otherwise, the signal will be very feeble and it won't be able to detect the low intensity signal. How we can improve the sensitivity, that we will see in the few upcoming slides. Basically, we will develop nanostructures for improving the sensitivity. Short response time also very critical if you are using your photo detector for high frequency applications. Noise should be minimum, or in other terms, we can say the dark current should be as low as possible. Low operating voltage and current. Yeah, because if the voltage and current requirement is quite higher, then the power dissipation will be very high. That will ultimately increase the temperature of the device, that may damage your device as well. And also for space application, where the very limited amount of that light electricity is available, because power generation is usually done by the solar cell, so the power available power is very low, so you want to keep your power consumption as low as possible. Therefore, the power consumption should be as low as possible. Reliability is another major issue. It should not be like it is work for several cycles and get damaged after that. Stability of the performance characteristic is another important parameter, because if you are using these devices for a longer duration of time, the device may become unstable. So you have to look into that characteristic also. You have to check your device for several cycles and for several hours for confirming the stability of the device. Small size, so that it can be easily integrated in the other like ICs or other devices. Yeah, another last one is the cost. You should not use very much complex systems to develop these devices, or you cannot use very high cost materials, which will increase the cost. Otherwise, it will limit its application in the day-to-day life applications. If you see the market of this optical sensor, it has increases exponentially with the time. In 2016, the approximately its market was size was $1.12 billion, which are expected to increase to $3.6 billion in 2024. Why is it so? Because of its application in different industries like oil and gas industries, where these optical sensors can be used for quality check purposes as well, and also to detect the fire in the mines, because whenever there will be a fire, there will be emission. Visible emission is there, IR emission is there, UV emission as well is there, and optical sensors can be used to detect fire in the mines as well. For aerospace and defense application, I will discuss in detail in the next slide. For medical application as well, like nowadays what is happening, if you want to supply some drug in your particular organ, then the drug is attached to this metal oxide, because they are biocompatible. You can inject them in human body, and you can track the position of these metal oxides as they have emissive properties as well. Therefore, they are getting very important in the medical application as well. In consumer electronics, like we are using our mobile handsets, there are IR sensors, ambient light sensors, all are optical sensors only. If you see their application, then they are also using in the temperature sensing as well. Like nowadays, when corona is everywhere, so when we are going to any mall or going to any institution, whenever you enter there, they will check your temperature using IR gun. It is just an optical sensor which is measuring your body temperature. For different biomedical applications, there are geological surveys, there are optical, for that people take optical images or thermal images, again use of optical sensors are there for biometric and ambience. So various applications are there. If we look specifically in the space and aeronautics applications, then it is used in the missile launching system and missile tracking systems as well, because there will be a flame at the back of that missile or rocket, which you can sense using optical sensors. So therefore, you can track with the current position of your missile or rocket. Also, it is being used in optical communication or in the intra-satellite communication. And in defense application, it can be used to know that someone has fire bullet over you, or missile is coming towards you. Because whenever there will be a fire, the UV emission will be there from the gun, and that UV emission will reach much before to you, before that bullet. Therefore, it will be easier to track the there is some you are in danger, so that you can save yourself. Another major application is UV dosimeter, which will give you the UV exposure, how much you are getting UV exposed. And now, like for sanitization, we are using UV lamps. There also we are using this kind of UV dosimeters, so that you can determine how much UV exposure is there and if it's sufficiently exposed, because the UV exposure will kill all the germs and bacteria and the viruses also. Therefore, it is a very important application of the optical sensors. Now we know that there are various optical sensors and find various applications, but the thing is how to fabricate this kind of photo detectors, where we want very high sensitivity, responsivity, very good performance we want, then how we can obtain that. For that, nanostructures play a very crucial role to improve the sensitivity of the material. Now, how it will happen? In planar configuration, as I have shown in the first schematic, as we see, the PN junction area is very small. Therefore, this will limit the sensing property of your detector. But if you can improve that junction area in the PN junction, then material sensing property will drastically improve. Why it will happen? Because the main sensing area of any PN junction device is that depletion region, which is formed at the junction of PN junction. So whenever a light incident on that in the depletion region, that to separate that electron hole pairs, which we get after excitation of electron from the valency band to conduction band, you require high electric field, which is available in the depletion region at the junction of PN, at PN junction. And in case of planar structure, this area is very small. And if we can improve this, like I have used nano rods here, therefore we are getting more junction area, okay, which will make the device more sensitive towards the incident optical light. So now, how we can obtain these metal oxide nanostructures? So there are certain ways, like VLS growth of nanostructures, which is VLS stand for vapor liquid solid. And for this method, first we will coat the substrate with the thin metal film, and then the substrate is heated at high temperature so that this thin film of metal will melt and will form the droplets over the substrate. Now the precursor vapor will enter in the deposition chamber, where this vapor will get diffused in the metal droplets and will start to supersaturate. Once supersaturation reach, it will start to precipitate down and get deposited at the bottom of the at bottom, and the water, that metal droplet, will move upward. So this process will continue and will give rise to nanorod like structures. Here you can easily control the diameter of the nanorods by controlling the film thickness and by controlling the heating temperature. This is the one way to obtain nanostructures. And the main question here is how you will get the precursor vapor here. So there are certain ways you can obtain this, like in the thermal evaporation method, you will heat that metal oxide material at high temperature. That will increase, that will also heat the material in the filament boat, and it will start to evaporate, and the substrate will be kept at the just top of the in that filament boat, and deposition will take place. Another method to heat that metal oxide material or target material is using laser or electron beams, which will result in the plume generation of plume, which a plume generally basically consists of the target material particles and charged particles as well. So that plume will, with the help of that plume, the material will, target material will deposit it at the over the substrate. There are some other possible ways as well, like chemical vapor deposition, RF magnetron sputtering. Different methods are there, but the major issue with this kind of method is that these methods are not suitable for large area fabrication, as we have seen that this deposition will take place at very high temperature and very low pressure, and to maintain it in a large area is very difficult. That is one thing. And also the deposition area itself is very low, because if you see the area of plume will be not be that much high. It will take lot of time to if you want to deposit over the larger area. And also the cost for that high vacuum conditions and temperature will be significantly high. That will ultimately increase the cost of your product. So which is not which we do not want actually. And also the kind of nanostructure that you will obtain will be very less. Like we I have explained nano rods, you can obtain, or thin film you can obtain. Otherwise to obtain different variety of nanostructures, it is very difficult here. The another way to obtain nanostructure is the hydrothermal growth process. In this method, what we will do, you will dip your substrate in the precursor solution and heat at around 90 to 150 degrees Celsius, and you will get nanostructure deposited over the your substrate. So the as you can see, the deposition temperature is very less, so you can work with the biodegradable or any kind of substrate which are not suitable for high temperature operations. So how this process works, firstly you have to clean the your glass substrate chemical cleaning. First you will ultrasonicate your sample in the acetone, then IPA, then DI. What is ultrasonication process? In this process you will keep your sample in a solution like say acetone, and high frequency vibrations, ultrasonic vibrations are there in the solution that will take out all the impurities or whatever deposited over the glass substrate. Okay, once you clean the glass substrate, you will deposit a seed layer. By different methods you can use spin coating. In this method you will drop cast the solution and spin the same your substrate at around 1000 3000 4000 whatever speed required RPM. You can spin coat the sample. Other methods are spray pyrolysis. You can also spray your sample. Deep coating is also there. So there are different techniques are available to form a thin film over this glass substrate. Now why seed layer is important for the hydrothermal growth? That is another question. Suppose we just kept that clean glass substrate in the that for the growth in the precursor solution. Then what will happen? The growth will take place and start taking place at in a solution itself. It won't be at the glass substrate only. But what we want selectively deposition at the glass substrate, which is not possible there. The growth will start taking place at the boundaries of the that beaker also in the solution everywhere. That is called homogeneous nucleation. But we want heterogeneous nucleation. What do you mean by heterogeneous nucleation? It should take place at the specific position, not everywhere in the solution. For that, we have to plant seeds over the substrate. That is why we are coating this seed layer over the glass substrate. Therefore, the deposition will only take place over the glass substrate, not in the solution. As a result, you will obtain different kind of nanostructures. Like we have precursor solution, you can use, like for zinc oxide, we have used zinc nitride and HMTA. Zinc nitride will act as a source of zinc ions, and HMTA will work as a source of, let's say, hydroxide ions. This zinc and hydroxide ion will react and form zinc hydroxide that will finally convert it to zinc oxide, which will get deposited over the your glass substrate. There are few advantage of this method. It is a Sol-Gel technique, and a very therefore large area fabrication is possible. There no need for high temperature or high vacuum condition is there. A very simple and cost effective. As you can see, the whatever equipment is required here, just an oven to heat the that precursor solution to 150 degrees Celsius. So the required equipment cost is very less. And you can obtain variety of nanostructure using this method. How you can obtain? Let us see. So zinc oxide basically is a polar semiconductor, and its top surface is rich of zinc ions, and which are positively charged, and its bottom surface is rich of oxygen and ions, which are negatively charged. Okay, so when you kept the seed layer coated sample in the your precursor solution, the ZnO2 minus ion, which are forming during the chemical reaction, will get deposited over the top surface of this seed layer. Why is it so? Because they are negatively charged, they will coulombically attracted towards the positively charged surface. That will leads to the formation of ZnO nano rods. As you can see the PSA images, we have obtained nano rods here over the glass substrate. Now, if you want to alter this process, and okay, we can obtain nanorod using BLS method as well. So what else we can obtain using hydrothermal growth? So yeah, if you add the trisodium citrate in the precursor solution, which has three negatively charges, you can see there are three CO bonds there, and three negative charges are there. And therefore, during the growth process, the citrate ions, which have three negative charges, will get deposited over the top surface of the this ZnO crystal, that will restrict the growth along the red direction. Now, the ZnO2 minus ions will start getting adsorbed over the non-polar facets, that side facets of ZnO crystal, and that will lead to the formation of nanoplate-like structure. Like we have obtained here, we have formed a very well connected network of ZnO nanoplates here. Another possible way to obtain different structure is using KMnO4 with citrate as in the precursor solution. So with the addition of KMnO4, as it is a strong oxidizing agent, it will increase the concentration of oxygen in the solution, and that will lead to the rapid formation of nanorods. And once nanorods are formed, the citrate ion will get absorbed over the top surface of the these ZnO nanorods and restrict the growth along that direction. And now, due to presence of trisodium citrate, the growth will start taking place around the nanorods, as I have also attached the same images for this as well. Finally, you will obtain these kind of nanostructures. These are basically nanorods, nanoplates around the nanorods. So that is how you can changing the precursor solution, you can obtain different kind of nanostructures during hydrothermal growth. Okay, now we have an active layer of our device as well with us. Now, just by depositing silver, any kind of metal electrodes over these semi-metal oxide films, you can obtain photodetectors. But there are a few figure of merits which you are looking for and which are very critical for your device performance. First one is photosensitivity. What does photosensitivity mean? How much sensitive your detector is towards the incident photons, incident light. It is determined by the ratio of the difference between the photocurrent to dark current, photocurrent minus dark current to the dark current. Another important figure of merit is photoresponsivity. How much responsive your device is to the incident light. It is calculated by taking the ratio of output current to the incident optical power. Next is specific detectivity. Now, what does it mean? How small a signal your device can detect? That is specified by specific detectivity. Your device should be differentiated between the dark current and the very small incident optical power as well. So, if the detectivity is high, it can detect very small intensity signal as well. Next is external quantum efficiency. What does it mean here? Suppose the photon wave incident on the your active layer and electron hole pairs are generated. And now, if these electron holes cannot be collected at the output, then it has no use. So, what are the number of charge carrier, photo generated charge carrier, which you are actually collecting at the output electrode? It is defined by external quantum efficiency. Now, linear dynamic range of the device, it is defined as the that is the range of the device in which your device will give a linear output response with respect to incident optical power. Okay. Now, there can be different categories of photodetectors depending on the transition of electron to their higher energy levels upon the incident of optical energy, like photoconductors or photovoltaics, where the output will be in terms of output current. And if it is photoelectric device, like when the photon will incident on the material, the electron will escape from the material, like it is photoelectric effect. For that, the energy of incident wavelength should be much higher, like in case of X-rays. These kind of photoelectric devices are very useful. Next is phonon generation. When the energy of incident photon is lesser than the band gap, then this kind of photodetectors are very important. Generally, this phonon generation will lead to the increase in the temperature of the material that can be detected. But now, for this talk, we are particularly interested in the photoconductive or photovoltaic kind of photodetectors. and based on the architectures, it can be divided in three different categories, like photoconductors, photodiodes, and phototransistors. So this is the basic device schematic of photoconductors that we have developed in our lab only. And for that, we have grown the ZnO nanostructures over the glass substrate, and over the this nanostructure, we have deposited silver electrodes. And the channel length was 50 micrometer, channel width was around 2 micrometers. Why we are that much interested in photoconductor? Because this is the simplest kind of architecture for a photodetector, and the gain is significantly high. You can detect very small incident signal as well. Therefore, these detectors are very important where the light intensity is very low. The only limitation with this kind of detectors are that the transit time may be sometime it can be higher, and which can be reduced by decreasing the electrode spacing. And the sensing mechanism in case of photodetector is like photoconductor type photodetector is completely different than the photodiode. Here I have explained the sensing mechanism. So let us consider a zinc oxide nanorods is there, and at room temperature there are lots of free electrons in the which are available at the surface of zinc oxide nanorods. But when it comes into contact of atmospheric oxygen, the oxygen will capture those free electrons at the surface and will lead to the formation of depletion region at the surface. That will significantly reduce the conductivity of the ZnO nanorods. Here the important thing is the thickness of the nanorods. If the thickness is much higher, then there will still be a conducting region in the at the center of nanorod that will help in the very high dark current. Yes, therefore the thickness is the very critical issue here. And okay, so for due to absorption of this oxygen at the surface, the depletion region, and due to the formation of depletion region, the conductivity will decrease. And as you shine the UV light over this sample, the electron hole pairs will generate, and these holes will reach to the surface, absorb oxygen, and get will release them. That will again re-establish the conductivity of the ZnO rods and result in the significantly high photocurrent. Now, why we were interested in different kind of nanostructures like nanorods, nanoplates, honeycomb, and different morphology that I have discussed. Why we were interested in different variety of nanostructures? Let us try to understand this. Like you have nanorod-like structures, and electron hole pair is generated here. Now, if it has to travel to the respective electrodes, like electron will move if it is it depends on the biasing. So electron and hole, they both have to reach their respective electrodes. For that, they have to travel this zigzag kind of path. Okay, so they have to travel very long path, and if their diffusion length is very less, then they won't be able to reach there. Also, they are quite junction capacitance between the barrier, potential barrier at the junction. That will again restrict the flow of these photogenerated charge carriers and restrict them to reach their respective electrodes. Therefore, the photo response of this kind of nanostructure is not that much good. And therefore, we have developed nanoplates like a very well connected nanoplate-like structure, which we have termed as honeycomb-like structures, where there is a direct path and there is no need to travel that longer path, and they can directly reach to their respective electrodes. And also, the thickness of rods is significantly high. As I have discussed in the previous slide, if the thickness is much larger, then there will be a conduction region that dark in under dark condition as well. Therefore, dark current will be very high. But in case of nanoplates, the thickness is very small. It is around 15 or 20 nanometer, and the thickness of depletion region itself is around 20 nanometers. So the complete nanostructure will get depleted. Therefore, dark current should be very small, and photocurrent should be very high, as it is there is a charge transportation efficiency significantly high. And as we can see in the obtained result, in case of nanorods, the very less enhancement in the photocurrent, around one order was there, 18 time enhancement in the photocurrent was there. And in case of honeycomb like structure, nanoplate structure, the enhancement in photocurrent is more than 5 orders. Also, the responsivity in case of nanorod was around 1.5 ampere per watt, which increased to more than 1000 in case of honeycomb-like structures. So they have a significant enhancement just by varying the morphology of the nanostructures. So there are a few advantages and disadvantages with this photoconductor type of photodetectors. But advantages, it is very easy to fabricate because the structure is very simple. And parasitic capacitance between the electrodes, it is very less. Therefore, RC time constant is very small compared to photodiodes. And smaller contact spacing, you can easily control the spacing between the two electrodes, which is but in case of photodiode, it will be it has to be thicker than, and because the P layer is there, N layer is there, so spacing is not have that much control. But here you can control the spacing. In case if you want larger surface area, you can deposit electrode in larger space. And if you want high speed, you can reduce the spacing between the electrodes, and also easy to integrate in the amplifier and waveguides. The major limitation is a large dark current noise, as I have discussed, especially in case of nanorod. However, we have reduced this, we have eliminated this limitation when we are using nanoplate like structures, and it requires higher operating voltage because there is no such built-in electric field which is available in case of photodiodes, which will separate out electron holes. So we have to apply external electric field. Therefore, it requires higher operating voltage, and response time is larger than the photodiodes. So next type is photodiodes. Here we are just a p-n junction. It is just a p-n junction which work in reverse bias, and there will be a depletion region at the p-n junction, as I have already discussed with you. In the depletion region, due to high built-in electric field, the electron which are excited from valence band to conduction band will get separated out with the under the influence of electric field, and will lead to the high photocurrent. So as you can see, the sensing mechanism has changed when we come from photoconductor to photodiodes. And the major thing is how you can obtain large quantum efficiency. Actually, you have to compromise between the response speed and the quantum efficiency, because if your depletion region is much wider, then only you can get more electron hole pairs, which you can use to get very high photo response. But if you are using very broad depletion region, then the drift time will increase, and also it will increase the response speed. It will decrease the response speed of your photodiode. So there are three major factors which are influencing the response speed of the photodiode. First one is let us consider that the photons are incidenting in the P region or N region, not in the depletion region. Then the diffusion time of those charge carriers will be much larger. That will increase the response time of the device. For that, you have to form the junction at very near to the surface. And another factor which is responsible for low response speed is the drift time of the carrier through the depletion region. There and to reduce that, you have to decrease the depletion region bit, so that your drift time can be reduced. But the problem is, if you reduce the depletion region width, it will increase the RC time constant. That will again increase the response time of the device. Therefore, you have to optimize the width of the depletion region to obtain optimum device performance. And researchers have found some different architectures, device architectures, which can be helpful for the improved device performance, like the pin photodiode. Here I stand for the intrinsic region between the P and N semiconductors. It is intrinsic region, and the response, the resistivity of the region is very high. And when you apply high forward bias between the across this device, the whole intrinsic region will get depleted. Therefore, now you have very broad region to accept the incident of photons, and therefore that will leads to very significantly high photocurrent. Compared to normal p-n junction, where you cannot have that much control over the width of the depletion region. Another possible configuration is Schottky barrier diode, where you are using only single kind of semiconductor. Generally, n-type semiconductors are used, and therefore it is majority charge carrier device, and which will be helpful in decreasing the response time of the device, as the NOMA entry carrier will be there, and absorption will take place at the metal semiconductor junction, and the sensing mechanism will be almost same when the there will be electron pair will get separated in the depletion region, and response speed is much higher in case of Schottky barrier photodiodes. Therefore, it can be used for high frequency operations. The charge carrier can be optical. Photo charge carriers can be generated in two different ways. In one way, when the energy of incident of photons is higher than the work function of the metal, but it is not desirable because it will increase the dark current of the device. The device are only suitable when the energy of incident light is just higher than the band gap of the material. That will lead to a very high photo current and also very good response speed. Another possible configuration of the photodiode is avalanche photodiode. Here also it is structurally very much similar to pin photodiode, but we have also added additional P layer near to N plus region. Here we are applying very high reverse bias voltage, which can be range up to 100 to 200 volts, which is sufficient for the avalanche multiplication. If you are not aware of what is avalanche multiplication is, under the influence of high bias conditions, the electrons will have very high kinetic energy, and when it will interact with the nearby free electrons, it will also accelerate the particle, and that will lead to the multi. And also, this accelerated particle will again impart their kinetic energy to other electrons. That will lead to the multiplication of free charge carriers. That will lead to very high internal gain of the photodiode. Also, response speed is much higher in case of avalanche photodiodes, and they are generally used for the optical fiber communication. Last category is the phototransistor. In this kind of photodetectors, the base will act as a photosensing layer, and when the light will incident, the conductivity of base will increase. That will result in the very high current flow. Unlike avalanche photodiode, the noise level of the phototransistor is very less. There's no avalanche multiplication process is there. By controlling the base current, you can obtain amplified signal here. The response speed of the phototransistor is not that much good because of the junction capacitance at the base collector junction. But you can obtain very high gain using these devices. So based on the application, you can use different kind of photo detectors. So that is all from my side. These are the few publications that I have published. A few in Journal of Quantum Electronics, IEEE Photonic Letters, in IEEE EDL, IEEE Sensor Letters, and some more journals are there. Also, my work in the Sensor Letter was published on the cover page. Then there are some more contribution in the other group members. And one book chapter in the Springer Nature. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Such a nice talk. Any questions from the students? Okay, Dr. Jitesh, can you tell me that how we can improve the response time of the device? Because these oxide semiconductors will have this oxygen adsorption and desorption process, right? So, is there any technique to improve the response time?
Yeah, you are asking in case of photoconductors.
Photoconductors and photodiodes, both the cases. How to improve the rise time and fall time?
Yeah, if you talk in terms of photoconductors specifically, the main reason behind that we are not getting that much quick photo response is that there is no built-in electric field that will separate out and trip the charge carrier. So you can deposit metallic nanoparticles, and due to that plasmonic actions, you can improve the photo response speed of the device. We are currently working on that. We have significantly reduced the response time as well. And this is the one thing. And also, as I have explained, by controlling the distance between the electrodes, you can also control the response speed. If you are the electrodes are nearer, then the response speed may there is some improvement. Or you can use Schottky junction here also. That will also improve the response time. So there are certain ways through which you can improve the response speed. Or if you want a response, then there are different configuration as I have discussed. If the response speed is the critical, then you can use Schottky barrier photodiodes or avalanche photodiode, which will provide you significantly quick response time.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So if no other questions, then I'd like to thank the presenter, Dr. Jitesh Agrawal, for a very interesting talk on oxide semiconductors based optoelectronic devices. I hope everybody got some good and interesting ideas regarding these kind of devices. Okay, thank you, Dr. Agrawal.
Okay, thank you, sir, for this opportunity. Thank you, everyone, for listening. Thank you.